Hello, welcome to the launch of our app, CASTA, Clinical Assessment System for Tuberculosis Analysis. On the outset, I would like to thank the Machine Intelligence Research Group and also the conference members for accepting our paper to be presented at this 21st International Conference for Intelligent Systems Design. And I would also like to thank and acknowledge the funding provided by Science and Engineering Research Board, DST, SERB of the Government of India, to do this work and come out with something useful for the society over the past 2 years. Above all, I am very indebted to thank the doctoral members, Dr. Subha Joyce, who is also a nodal TB officer, and Dr. Singh, Dr. Julie, Dr. Moses, who are also some of the TB officers, clinicians, and immunologists who are in this domain, who are working in close collaboration with us across from various parts of South India, Chennai, Nagarkoil, Thiruvananthapuram, and so on. Tuberculin skin test, also known as TST or the Mantoux test, is a test that is used to detect the level of tuberculin infection, latent tuberculin infection in children and in adults. So an individual suffering from TB is generally sensitive to this tuberculin injection. The individual is administered this by injecting a little amount of 1 or 2 ml of the tuberculin into the forearm, and it causes a small induration, a small boil kind of a growth. And if the patient is sensitive, then within 48 to 72 hours, the patient will be able to see a bulge in that induration that was initially injected. And the clinician used to record the induration using a ballpoint pen. They used to make markers around the boil, and then they used a vernier calipers or even an ordinary scale to see how much it has bulged or grown. Like the color changes or the redness around the induration is not considered, whereas they only see how much of the bulge has come out. So there can be some inconsistencies involved in this observation. So that is where we come into picture. So what that which seems to be an induration for one clinician may not be an induration for another. One may say that 2 millimeter is growth, and another one may say this is not a growth, it is not a substantial growth. And that kind of an inconsistency and weakness is still existing in the observations of this test. Moreover, to report for this test, after getting injected, the patient has to come back to the lab 48 hours, that is after 2 days or sometimes even after 3 days to give a report. So most of the cases in India, the patient come for testing and after 2-3 days, you see that there is not much growth, and they completely ignore and they say that it is not reactive, and they make a decision by themselves. So by this, the test is getting underutilized. So in order to avoid all these things, we thought there should be some means of communication between the clinicians and the patient. So this is not only our initiative for developing this CASTA app, not only tries to minimize the inconsistencies involved in the observations of this test, but it also tries to improve the clinician and patient interaction, and also tries to enhance the data handling by keeping a track of this historical data so that the clinician and the patients might be might use the data in future. The input images are obtained in PNG format from the medical photographs shot using mobile phones, and with the application of histogram equalization and the grayscale conversion, the images are enhanced, and there is a contrast generated between the foreground and the background. Austro's thresholding method, very popular segmentation algorithm. So it iteratively determines the segmentation threshold by minimizing the intra-class variance in the respective classes. So the second approach we tried was the region growing method. First, number of seed points are defined individually on cropped wheel images on the upper intensity and the lower intensity levels. Then the individual seed points are examined for its closeness to the marker values or the seed values, and they are labeled as 0 or 1 based on the threshold defined in the difference in the intensity levels. So after which the current pixel and the seed pixels are thresholded based on the intensity level. Next, these regions are built, examined over 4 to 8 neighboring pixels or neighboring neighbors based on the intensity. So the corresponding region grows by joining those adjacent neighboring pixels to every seed point, which have a preset threshold and the connectivity properties. The third method which we tried was the watershed algorithm. So in this method, image is visualized in three dimensions. One, of course, two is the spatial coordinates, and the third one is the intensity of the image pixel. So it reads pixel and their corresponding values as a local elevation, like a kind of a topography, and has user-defined markers. The method floods the basins over the user-defined markers till the basins that are recognized for different markers run into watershed lines. So in most of the cases, the selection of the markers in the local minima of the image for where the basins are flooded. It involves choosing a minimum of one seed value or marker value inside each entity of the image while considering the background as a distinct entity. These four algorithms are available for the Kinesian. Apart from once an image is got from the medical photography technique, the clinician can draw or annotate around the boil for the first reading, and afterwards even for the consequent reading he can do that same annotation. And then these algorithms can be used for giving their own reading.
Just now we looked about the image processing algorithms and how they are implemented. Now let us look into the mobile aspect of it. So mobile, everyone around the world uses a mobile. Even you would have a mobile. And the mobile computation has come to another level right now, where you can play like PC level games on right in your mobile phone, and also do many other sorts of communications, texting, messaging, and everything in just in your hand. So now we'll look into the image processing algorithms and how they are implemented in mobile computation. So the whole mobile architecture is divided into two parts, the front end and the back end. The front end is the UI UX that the user sees and uses, and the back end is the background application which are running in a server somewhere, which has all the logics and all the processing that happens, which then gives you the desired result that you want. The backend architecture for our Casta app has three parts. The first one being the Node.js server, and the Flask server, and the MongoDB. Coming to Node.js, many of the web developers would know about Node.js because they would be using that for their programs. That is like Mern stack, and there are many other stacks which involve Node.js. So we are using Node.js as the main server for our application, and that will act as the main endpoint for which our app sends the request to get the response. Then we have the Flask. So Flask, we use it as a microservice which does all the image processing, and it runs all the image processing code from Python and sends back the results to Node.js server. Then we have MongoDB. So MongoDB is a NoSQL database. It has a document-oriented object, and it is very useful to our use case because all our images and all the URLs act as like a document database. Coming to the front end. The front end is the UI UX which the user uses, and we use React Native to build the front end. Why we use React? So React Native has been built by Facebook itself, and it's a very big library just because it can be used to create applications for Android, for iOS, for web, for Windows, or any platform you would like to have. So for our application, the Casta application, we want both the iOS users as well as the Android users to get benefit from it. So therefore we are using React Native so that we can create a one code base and create a one whole application and deliver it for both Android users as well as the iOS users. The front end and back end communicate via HTTP REST API protocol, and we also use something called Amazon Web Services and a service called S3 in that. So what does S3 do? So S3 is a service which AWS provides, which can help us to store images, files, or anything, any data related matter. So whatever the images that we get from the user and whatever the images that we process, we send it to AWS S3, and we get the URLs from there to store in our database and to deliver it to our users to view it in their app. We have built by both the Node.js and Flask server in an Oracle instance, which runs 24/7 so that we have a good uptime and that users can use it anytime they want. We use Expo in React Native, it is a library which will convert all the code that we have into build files, which can be then sent to iOS and Android app stores.
Furthermore, if you have any queries regarding the image processing aspects or the algorithm aspects, you can contact me. And if you have any queries regarding the clinical aspects of the work, how to go about the sensitivity analysis of tuberculosis or allergen skin test, or how the tests are administered, and all these kind of clinical details about this work, you have our team of doctors, Dr. Subhash Joyce and Dr. Bhakta Singh. You can contact them. And if you have any queries regarding the technical aspects of this work, about the implementation, the server side, the database, and all these things, and the app, mobile app, of course, you can contact Jonathan, who is also available. So finally, thanks for watching. If you have any queries, we are freely available unto you.
you can contact us anytime. Thank you.